Morning, church. Let's stand to our feet.
Great to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? I know that I'm so glad that we're here worshiping Jesus together. I'm out of breath out of that song. I want to read this passage. I have Psalm chapter 40. It says this: I waited patiently for the Lord to help me, and he turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out of the mud and the mire. And he set my feet on solid ground and steadied me as I walked along. He's given me a new song to sing, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see what he has done and be amazed. They will put their trust in the Lord. Church, what I have to say to you right now is short and simple. Don't let this moment pass. Don't let this morning go to waste. You know, we serve an awesome God who has done great things, who has worked in our lives, who has been faithful in the past, and he'll be faithful to us in the future. So I don't know what you're carrying in with you this morning. I don't know if you're carrying joy. I don't know if you're carrying fear, doubt. But whatever you're carrying, can you lay it at the feet of Jesus this morning? Can we just spend this morning worshiping him and putting our trust in him? Come on, sir. Come on, sing this.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Everything around me shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so why would he fail now? He won't.
I've still got joy in chaos.
I've still got joy in chaos.
Sing it.
I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going on.
That's right.
I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I've been my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let our first foundation.
worship you, and you are here working in this place. I worship you.
Let this be your prayer.
You are here. don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop.
Miracle worker, you're so good to us, and Lord, we give you our praise this morning. We thank you that you are at work in our lives, even when we can't see it. God, you are always constant. You are always faithful. We're so grateful for you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, amen. Woo. Good morning. My name is Stephanie. I'm the Central Women's Director here at Harvest, and I'm so glad you're here this morning. If this is your first time, special welcome to you. So glad you decided to check out Harvest today. I'll be in the lobby after service, and I'd love to meet you, answer any questions you have, and help you get connected here at Harvest. So there's a table out there that says welcome, and I'd love to meet you out there. But for everyone here, we want to make sure you're getting plugged into the life of the church, that we know what's going on in your life, that we're able to pray for you and partner with you and make sure that you feel known here at the church. And one of the ways we do that is through the Connect card on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So pull out your phones right now and click the Connect card. You can check in, let us know that you're here, and also let us know any prayer requests and see a lot of other resources to get plugged in here at Harvest. So make sure you take an opportunity to do that today. Next weekend is our Women on Mission Conference. Woo! I am so excited and expectant for what God's going to do. It's Friday and Saturday, March 15th and 16th here at the Meadows campus. And it's been so incredible to see how many women are signing up and excited to dive into what it looks like to be devoted to a loving God. And we're going to go through teaching and workshops, and we're going to have a vendor hall and a lot of other fun things. So if you aren't signed up, please sign up. It's going to be awesome. And we have our Good Friday and Easter services coming up so soon. And we are prayerful, and we are excited to see what God's going to do in our Good Friday and Easter services. So Friday, March 29th, we have a 5 and a 7 p.m. service. And then Saturday, March 30th, we have a 5 p.m. And then Sunday, March 31st, we have a 9 and 11 a.m. service. So there's plenty of opportunities to come and enjoy a Good Friday and an Easter service. Bring your family, bring your friends, anyone you think who would be blessed by these services. We want to be able to have a culture of invite and be able to bring people who we think need to hear the good news of Jesus and get to celebrate together. In Psalm 95, 3 through 6, it says, "For the Lord is a great God and a great king above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our maker." As we give today, I want to remind you that this is worship. This is not just giving money. This is an act of worship and adoration to the Lord, being reminded that everything is from him and through him. And so as we give today, have a heart and an attitude of worship, because he deserves it. He is so worthy and so holy. And there are several ways listed to give on the screen. So whether you give today or throughout the week, we're going to take time to pray for our offering, praying for the Lord to work and to be able to bless the offerings we give him. And we're also going to be praying for High Point Church and Pastor Ron Zappia over in Naperville. It's been so amazing to see what's going on at High Point and just the work they're doing there. And we get to lift up this brother in Christ and his congregation. We're going to pray for that and then also pray for our services today as we continue in worship. So let's pray together. Lord, we praise you for who you are. You are so holy and magnificent. And Lord, you are creator. And Lord, we thank you for all the things you've given us. Lord, I pray as we give today that, Lord, we give out of an outflow of recognizing how wonderful you are and how everything is from you. And so, Lord, as we give today and this week, may our hearts be stirred to give generously and to give with a heart of adoration, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the work you're doing in the Chicagoland area, and I thank you for what you're doing at High Point Church. I thank you for Pastor Ron, and Lord, I pray you bless him and equip him and and prepare him for the Easter season. Lord, I pray that you continue to move in their services and move in their church and continue to bring new people into the life of their church. And Lord, I pray for our services today. Lord, I thank you that you're already moving. You're already working in our hearts and lives. And so, Lord, I pray that as we dive into your word and as we continue in worship, that, Lord, you stir our affections toward you. And, Lord, we focus our attention. That, Lord, you remove any distractions and we're able to focus on the good news of what Christ has done for us. Lord, we thank you for the cross and the resurrection of Jesus. You've been so good to us. So we praise you. We lift high your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's continue in worship.
It is by his death that I am. by his death that I am alive. Because of Christ, I am alive. Because of Christ, I am alive. Because of Christ, I am alive. I am alive. So Jesus, today we thank you for the cross. Lord, as we go into Easter season, we thank you for the blood that was shed for us. We are reminded of the fact that you gave the ultimate price to bring us back to you, to save us from our sins, to sanctify us, Lord. So Father, I pray we wouldn't lose sight of that. I pray that we would hone in. I pray that we would draw near to you this morning. As we open your word, I pray that we would receive what you have for us and give you all the praise and glory. I pray this in your son's precious and holy name. Amen. Church, you can have a seat and open up your Bibles.
Good to see you. How are you? Hey, this is my friend Corey. Corey's actually one of the campus pastors of our church. He's up at the North Shore campus, and we've got some really cool things that are happening there. One of the things, the reason that he actually came to Chicago from a little place called Canada, a little place called British Columbia.
Totally, eh? Yeah. Long ways.
So it's just the Canadian show, eh?
It is a beauty, eh?
Some buckets up here. It's going to be hosers. Great, eh?
Yeah.
Corey came because he's got a background in church planting, and so one of the things that we've been thinking about for the last while is what kind of potential we have at our North Shore campus in terms of how it is that we can reach that community. One of the things that became pretty clear to us was that the best way to reach a community is through a localized local church, and by that I mean not just a video venue type thing, but like a church that is going to be its own kind of sending thing. So it's one of the things that we've been trying to do with our North Shore campus, and so we're going to kind of relaunch it in that with that vision in the next little while. Corey, tell us a little bit about yourself. You preached here a little while ago, some of you guys remember, but tell us about yourself.
Okay.
Where have you worked before?
Thank you. Great to be here with you, Pastor Jeff. Good morning, everybody. As Pastor Jeff mentioned, my name's Corey Anderson. I'm married to my wife, Trina, for 30 years now. We just hit the anniversary not too long ago. Got 4 kids, all grown, 2 grandkids. Been a church planter in the state of Utah. Therefore, lived there for 18 years, planted for 14. Been in British Columbia, been a few places in Canada as pastor, youth pastor, been all over the place, it seems like. And now landed here. I'm really excited to be here and to be a part of Harvest and the North Shore and what God's going to be doing at the North Shore and is doing already, actually.
So you actually have a request of us here, especially, that's going to have to end before I preach a sermon, but listen, especially for Rolling Meadows, for the campus here.
Yes, in fact, and that's exactly why I'm here this morning, is that as we build towards relaunching, we are looking at a relaunch of our campus at the North Shore on October the 6th. And so between now and then, we've got a lot of work to do at the North Shore. A lot of work is already being done. We're going through a couple of different phases right now. We've been working on revitalization, working on rebuilding, not only some of our facility things, but also a lot of our ministries that are just kind of haven't been in place for a while. And then the last thing is to actually do the relaunch of the campus on October 6th. So why I'm here today because I want to give you an invitation. I want to invite you to come and join us. And we've been praying that maybe the Lord might touch some of you on the shoulder, so to speak, and just say, hey, I'd like you to go over to the North Shore and be a part of that campus. We're really looking for people that will just kind of commit to being with us. We're not looking at a time frame or anything like that or how long, but we're just really are looking for people to come over and join us. In particular, what we really need to do in order to relaunch, we're a campus of about 60 people right now. And it's been a lot higher in the past, and yet we believe that greater days are still ahead for that campus. It's definitely a long way from being over, but we really actually need younger families. And honestly, like anybody comes, it would be wonderful, right? It would be. When I say younger families, it's because our children's ministry, and if we want to reach younger families, we have to have younger families, and we have to have kids. And so my invitation to you is if you have any interest or inclination, you've got questions you might consider, you live between here and Highland Park area, right after the service, I'm going to be in the Hope Center, and I've got a little sort of a document that I want to walk you through. I would just need this morning about maybe 10 to 15 minutes of your time so that I could just kind of share with you kind of what I'm asking for with more clarity, because I am asking for a commitment. Realize you can't make a commitment on the spot necessarily and sign a dotted line, but we are really looking forward to going ahead because we've got training and everything that we're doing, and we have 9 months to kind of give birth to this baby that's already been born 12 years ago, yeah. Right? So it's sort of a rebirth of the baby. So really exciting. The harvest is plentiful, right? The harvest is plentiful. I mean, I have conversations all the time out in that area with people about spiritual matters. There's people that need to know Jesus, and so if you want to join us on mission, what a great mission opportunity. I'd love to partner with you. So thank you so much.
So after this service, just across the hallway right in here, by the way, he's not going to be standing at the door and like, sign, get the commitment right now. It's an information sort of thing. And we'll be reminding you as time goes along. I'm going to pray for Corey, and then we're going to preach, study God's word together. Lord, I'm thankful for my friend, and I'm thankful, Father, that, for our shared history, and for the many ways that you've both blessed him and blessed the work of his hands in Utah and in Canada and now here. And I pray, Father, that, I pray for the North Shore campus, that in the days to come, it would become a beacon of light as it has been in the past, a beacon of light and an opportunity, Father, to send forth not just that church, but church planters and all over the area up there, Father, that we'd see lots and lots of people come to faith in Christ there. There's so much need. So few churches that are proclaiming the gospel clearly and studying God's word without apology. And I pray, Father, that this would be just the beginning of something really, really cool. We look back maybe on this day, years to come, and say, I remember when we were asked to do that and see what the Lord's done with that willingness. So we love you and we're thankful. In Jesus' name, amen. Give him
thanks,
a big
everyone.
Round of applause?
Thanks, everyone. Hope to see you in the Hope Center.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, buddy. So you need a Bible, Matthew 13. Matthew 13, we're going to look at verses 31 to 33. Just two little stories, two little parables today. While you're turning your Bibles there, Matthew 13, verse 31, I've been in a city where a president has been visiting twice in my life. Once was here in Chicago, when they shut the whole city down for President Obama, which was weird for me because I thought he lived here, and so, like, is it always shut down? But I was visiting. The other time was when actually I was in Atlanta when President Trump was visiting. I didn't know it at the time. We were there for a baseball tournament that was a little bit northwest of the city, and so we were driving on the highway that goes from the northwest of the city back down into the city. One of the things I noticed was every overpass that we were going by was packed with police. And I was like, what in the world is happening here? There must be a parade. There must be some big, big thing going on. But every time we kept driving, there'd be police. And then the further on we went, the fewer and fewer cars there were until there were zero cars coming the other way. And this was like 4 o'clock on a Tuesday. I was like, what in the world is happening to the freeway? There must have been some colossal accident that took place. And I was even mentioning it to my kid. Have you ever seen a freeway completely bare with police cars at every overpass. And they were like, I don't know, this is odd. Until finally, we came to a section where a car was driving out sort of toward the front, and there were police cars all behind it, and then other police cars that were pulling up right next to it. And I was like, either that's OJ or that's Trump, right? And I realized, oh, okay, that's right. He's in town. For some reason I didn't think about it. I don't really track Donald Trump's life very much, but then I realized, oh my gosh, that he's around. And then I started having a conversation with my sons about what kinds of crazy things people do in order to facilitate the visit of a president of the United States. And I told them the stories about when I was in Chicago and I was on the bus and they kicked everyone off the bus because we were getting close to the United Center, and apparently his car might come by the United Center, Obama's at the time, but everybody needed to get off. And then I told them about this guy I was sitting next to one time on a plane, and he was actually former Secret Service. And of course, former Secret Service guy sitting next to you, you're like, all right, so what happened with JFK? And like, you want to know all this stuff. And he's like, nah, I mean, I don't know anything like that. But I said, what an interesting job that you have, man. You have to follow around dignitaries and whatever all the time. He goes, you know what most of my job is? I said, what? He said, guarding dumpsters. And I was like, really? He said, yeah, what they do is they send an advanced team in to wherever the president's going to be, and I'm supposed to guard dumpsters or roadways or something like that. You have to, for like days in advance, to make sure nobody goes and puts a bomb in a dumpster or hides themselves with a sniper rifle there. And I was like, oh, I don't think I want to be in the Secret Service now. Not that I ever did, but what a horrible, boring job. I've been in New Zealand. When one of the royal family visited, and the whole country shut down. Like, I mean it. Everybody was like, okay, nobody go anywhere, because, you know, Kate might want to come this way. Usually, the greeting that you show to a dignitary, the size and pomp and circumstance of the greeting is commensurate with the pomp and circumstance and standing of the dignitary. Does that make sense? Like if Joe Biden visited our church today, we'd be, oh, yeah, it's a big deal, right? But if, you know, the president of Noonga Boonga Boonga that you've never heard of ever, you'd be like, hey, you want to get some Chick-fil-A? Oh, it's closed. You know, like, you wouldn't go, let's go to Cane's. You wouldn't treat them the same way because, their role and their standing isn't quite as high as the other guy's role and standing. Which means, of course, that if you get a big-time dignitary, big-time king, you have a big-time welcome. That's how you know he's a big-time king half the time. Which raises some weird questions about Jesus, doesn't it? Like every Christmas, we try to talk a little bit about, okay, Jesus is coming, Son of God, born on earth. Here he comes. And where's the red carpet? Well, I guess it's in the barn. He shows up, he's born, and there's a bunch of animals around. One of my favorite little written pieces that raises this question around the Christmas season is by Philip Yancey in his book, The Jesus I Never Knew. Here's what he wrote. You might have heard me read it before. I read it all the time because it's such a poignant little piece to try and focus your mind around, oh my goodness, how crazy is this that the Son of God is coming and welcomed like he is. He said, the God who roared, who could order armies and empires about like pawns on a chessboard, this God emerged in Palestine as a baby who couldn't speak or eat solid food or control his bladder, and who depended on a teenager for shelter, food, and love. Once when I was in London at a performance of Handel's Messiah, I looked toward the auditorium's royal box where the queen and her family sat, and I caught glimpses of the more typical way rulers stride through the world with bodyguards and trumpet fanfare and a flourish of bright clothes and flashing jewelry. Queen Elizabeth II had recently visited the United States, and reporters delighted in spelling out the logistics involved. She had 450 pounds of luggage, what my wife travels with a lot. 450 pounds of luggage, including two outfits for every occasion. She had a morning outfit in case someone died, 40 pints of plasma, and white kid leather toilet seat covers for the royal bum, I guess. She brought along her own hairdresser, two valets, and a host of other attendants. A brief visit to a foreign country of royalty can easily cost $20 million. In meek contrast, God's visit to earth took place in an animal shelter with no attendants present and nowhere to lay the newborn king but a feed trough. Indeed, the event that divided history and even our calendars into two parts may have had more animal than human witnesses. A mule could have stepped on him. So what does that say about his importance? I mean, most of us should look at that and say, well, it means he's insignificant, right? Or maybe they just didn't know the significance. Like, what are we to do? What are we to do with the fact that the God of all eternity, when he chose to arrive, did it that way? If I'm a king, then I'm going to make everybody bow down. I'm going to make it so that everyone knows when I show up. I want the presidential suite. I want to be at the Four Seasons or the Waldorf Astoria. But not in a barn. So what are we to make both of this king who shows up in such quiet insignificance and also of the kingdom he's supposed to bring? Why so quiet? Why so insignificant? Is it going to stay that way? And how do people like you and me, who are following that quiet, somewhat insignificant-seeming king, in a world where everybody's like, yeah, he is pretty insignificant, I don't really, you know, Jesus, whatever, blah, 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 blah. But yet he promises that his kingdom is going to be so grand and great. Like, what do we do with that fact that we live between the little tiny quiet and then the big kingdom has come? Like, what? How do we live? What should we expect? This is what Matthew 13 is basically about. It's about the kingdom of heaven. It's about the kingdom of God. What's this kingdom like that this king brings? And how is it different than the kingdoms of this age? And so we're taking a look at it over a series of weeks here through a series of parables, these stories that Jesus is telling. And today, Matthew 13, 31 to 33, there are these two really short parables that he tells back to back, and in them, we're going to learn one thing from each one of the parables. Number one, we're going to learn that this kingdom, although it starts really insignificant, it has a huge growth to it. It's surprising in its growth. And second, that the kingdom of heaven has surprising influence. It grows from little to big, and it grows from insignificant to significant. So let's look at the two parables. The first one actually tells the story that the kingdom of heaven has surprising growth, and it's about a mustard seed, which nobody knows what that is, but I'll show you a picture of it. It's okay. He put another parable before them, Matthew 13, 31. He put another parable before them. Now, before we get too far here, I am going to stop, and I want to tell you a little bit about the context of Matthew 13. So, like, when Matthew sits down and he's going to write his gospel, he has lots of stories to choose from. So when he arranges them for a point. And there is a point regarding why Matthew 13 is about parables and what parables are supposed to be about and what they're supposed to do to those who hear them. So here's what happened the chapter before in Matthew 12. What you've got basically is the religious leaders, the Pharisees, who were basically the, what do you call it, the the health inspectors of the day, the religious health inspectors of the day. Whenever I think about a health inspector, I think about somebody who's got a little pad of paper and they walk around and follow you all the time and go, that's very interesting. You're doing that wrong. It's doing horrible. You know people like this, you know, the health inspectors in your life? Oh, they're irritating. You're like, can you just go someone else's place and find rats there? Right? But that's what I view the Pharisees were like, because they were like, look, it's our job to make sure everybody keeps the law. Okay? And we try to make it easy for you to keep the law. There's certain things you can do, and there's certain things you can't do. One of the big things you can't do is do anything on the Sabbath day, because that's the law of God, and it's God of God's a good thing, so we're here to make sure, you know, you're doing. We're the religious police, and we're going to make sure you do the things that you need to do. And so they followed Jesus around like this, and they would make sure that he and his disciples were doing the things, because they wanted to evaluate whether or not these guys were the real deal, and should we follow you? How should we think about you? You're claiming all these great things, but are you a law keeper? Are you the kind of person who's going to, you know, meet our standards and blah, blah, blah? So one day they're walking through a field and his disciples are hungry, and so Jesus is like, hey, just grab some of the grain, for, you know, so the wheat is got its bud, and so, you know, grab it, rub it together, maybe throw that grain in the old gullet there, and that'll be great. Now, these, the religious leaders are like, whoa, wait a minute, when I look up, you know, in the guide here, it says that's harvesting. I guess so, man. I guess it is. And that's work. Harvesting is work, and work isn't to be done on the Sabbath. So Jesus, we've got a question for you. Why is it that your disciples are working on the Sabbath? And Jesus is like, oh my word, this is ridiculous, you guys. That's not, you know, the law was given for people, not to punish them, okay? Like, it was given to benefit, okay. And so they're mad at him. And they're like, well, that's a check against Jesus. And then he goes and he takes it one step further. He walks by a guy with a withered hand. Right? And so he heals this guy on the Sabbath. And they're like, now, okay, so that's work. You're playing doctor now, you know? And they're freaking out. And Jesus, just think about that for a minute, right? You need to make sure that you wait till Monday or tomorrow to make sure that happens. To heal the guy, to help him. Yeah, that's right. Leave him there in his distress. Okay. But they're against him. And Jesus actually points it out to them. You guys are being ridiculous. And at that point, they're like, all right, you're not on our team. We're going to kill you. So things continue. He ratchets it up one more level. He goes over and he casts a demon out of a guy. Which, by the way, would be something you and I would be like, oh my goodness, this guy's free, spiritually free from the prison that he was in. And they're like, well, the only reason he's able to cast out demons is because he works for the prince of demons. No. He serves Satan. And that's how he's able to do this. So you can see that it's just opposition, 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 opposition. Finally, Jesus gets to the point in Matthew 12:38, as some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him. I always enjoy this because it's like nobody asks you dudes questions. That's what health inspectors are like. Well, I've got an answer for you. Be quiet. Go away. I didn't ask you anything. Some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him saying, teacher, we wish to see a sign from you. By the way, the guy's been doing like miracles all over the place. Hey, I just cast the demon out, right? I just healed a guy with a withered hand. Can we see a sign? But he answered them, an evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign. This is sarcasm. Oh, you want a sign, do you? No sign's going to be given to it. Except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. You guys think that you're the health inspectors and you're checking on me? I'm telling you right now that at the day of judgment, all the people of Nineveh, the wicked people of Nineveh, will rise up and they will condemn you Because when Jonah showed up, they responded to him. They repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here. They repented at Jonah, and the Son of Man is before you, and you're mocking him. How do you think that's going to go with the judgment? When I return in power on the horse with the tattoo down the leg and the sword coming out, what do you think? So my point here is Matthew 12 is all about a bunch of religious leaders and opposition to Jesus and his ministry. Okay? And then in Matthew 13, he tells a whole bunch of stories. Yes, to encourage his disciples about the kingdom of heaven, but also as a poke to his opponents about the kingdom of heaven. You guys think that I'm some insignificant nothing, that I should be treated like you would treat, you know, your clients as health inspectors. You think that you have some authority over me. You think that you can oppose me because I don't meet up to your standards. You think that all of that is true, do you? Well, let me tell you about the kingdom, the one that I bring. Oh, what about it? All right. He put a parable before them, both his disciples and the listening. Remember, the guys are on the edge of the thing going, there's a lot of people over here. Is there a fire code being broken? He put another parable before them saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all seeds. He's not claiming that every single seed in the world, he's not comparing mustard seed to every seed in the world. He's saying, like, as a farmer, the smallest seed that you'll ever deal with is a mustard seed. How small? That small. It's not very big, right? Speak of insignificant. This is not like Andre the Giant's thumb here. This is little tiny guy. You probably lose that in your house. You probably have this in your house. It's in your rug. The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man who took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all seeds, but when it is grown, it's larger than all the garden plants. He's not talking about every tree in the world here. He's basically saying, listen, when you sow this seed, when you put it in the ground, it ends up growing to such a degree that it's shocking how big a thing comes from such a little thing. Now, most mustard trees would only come up, they were bushes. They would only come about 4 feet, just about this high. But in the right conditions and in the right garden, they could grow up to like 15 feet. They could grow like 15 feet tall. There's a mustard tree. So this little tiny seed grows up into this massive tree. So that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. This is a really important image. It's drawn from the Old Testament. The picture of a tree with birds perched in its branches, providing shade to all of the birds of the heavens, it's the language that's used, is one that's used in the Old Testament to talk about kingdoms that are enormous and kingdoms that cover the whole earth, basically. There's a vision that Nebuchadnezzar has in Daniel. And Nebuchadnezzar has this dream. Nobody can interpret it. He comes to Daniel. Daniel's like, well, let me have a try. And here's what Nebuchadnezzar tells him. Here's my vision. As I lay in bed, the visions were these. I saw and behold a tree in the midst of the earth, and its height was great. The tree grew and became strong, and the top reached heaven. And it was visible to the end of the whole earth. Its leaves were beautiful, its fruit abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it, and the birds of the heavens, it's the same phrase that Jesus uses, lived in its branches, and all flesh was fed from it. The picture he's drawing is basically saying, this kingdom that I come and I bring starts so tiny as this little mustard seed, but then it grows to be so great that in fact it overtakes all the kingdoms of the world, and they, all the kings who you rely on, actually come and they nest in the branches. It's that grand. Or to put it another way, it has surprising growth. Despite its remarkably humble beginning, it's going to grow and provide for and govern the whole world. All right, so that's the meaning of this parable. So let's think about that for a minute. What implications are there for us as we think about the fact that the kingdom of heaven starts small, insignificant in a barn, and then grows to cover the whole earth in its fullness? Well, one implication is, okay, don't be surprised then if people, when it's small, treat it like it's small. Don't be surprised by opposition, by people mocking those who actually follow in the way of the kingdom. Look, if you're a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, which every Christian who has put their faith in Jesus is, it's going to make you live in a particular manner. That manner is the same manner that Jesus lives. That's actually what it means to follow Jesus, right? He's the king. We follow the king in a way of his kingdom. And we should probably expect that if we do that, we're going to get the same result that Jesus did. Well, what did he get when he was living in his way of the kingdom? A bunch of know-nothing. A bunch of opponents. The Romans killed him in the end. So it's not just people who were, you know, religiously inclined. It was people who were not religiously inclined. He just had a ton of opposition. Is the king, our king, was mocked and dismissed. We're going to be mocked and dismissed too. Guys, it's normal. As you live in this world as a follower of King Jesus, as a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, don't be surprised if the citizens of the kingdoms of this age think you're an idiot. There is a passage in 1 Peter 4 that I love. It's because it's so straightforward. The people he's writing to are starting to face what I'd call stink eye persecution. Do you know, it's like not full-blown persecution where someone comes and beats you up. It's stink eye, like, what's going on with you? Did you see this dude over here? Like, what an idiot, right? Let me blog about him. Sorry, tweet about him. Whatever, X about him. He says, beloved, don't be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you. Oh, everybody is opposing and thinking I'm stupid for believing in Jesus and following his sexual ethics. Everybody thinks I'm crazy because I believe that Jesus is the only way. Everybody thinks I'm judgmental because I don't believe certain ways of life are honoring to God. Woe is me. And Peter's like, why are you surprised? Why are you surprised by this? Don't be surprised as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. See, in other words, the fact that you're sharing in the sufferings of Christ is probably evidence that you're following Christ. If your king went through this path and faced certain obstacles, you know you're on the same path as your king if you're on the path and you face obstacles, right? If you don't face obstacles, I would wonder if you're on the same path as the king. If you're not facing the opposition, if you're not being mocked and scorned, I'd start thinking to myself, I wonder if you just totally packed it in. Or you've just decided, I'm just going to keep my head down around here, you know, and just go along. Look, Christians, don't be afraid when everything comes to oppose you in your work. You might lose your job. You know that? We might lose our jobs. You're not the first Christian people in the history of the world who have lost their jobs. In the early church, the actors all lost their jobs. Praise the Lord. Just kidding. The actors all lost their job. You know why? Because acting was an act of worship to the deity. You'd actually, that's what they did when you went to the, to When you went to the play, before they did the play, they would do a little incense and throw it in the air, and there it was. You were, this whole thing is an act of worship to the god Dionysius or whatever. And Christians were like, I can't do that. I can't do that. And when they said, I can't do that, we're not going to do that, you know what everybody said? What an idiot. You follow this Jesus? Who is this Jesus? He's so insignificant and meaningless. Right. Right. Dude, I remember when I was sitting in a chair getting my hair cut in New Zealand, which is one of the most secular places I've ever been in my life. So I'm sitting there getting my hair cut in this chair, and the lady starts asking me, what are you doing here? And by that, I don't mean like getting your hair cut. I mean, what are you doing here in New Zealand? I said, well, I'm here. I'm actually a pastor of a church. She said, a what? So like, you know how churches have leaders in the churches, and they come, and she said, oh, okay. Like you marry people, like a priest, you marry people and bury people. It's kind of like that. She said, there's no priests who are Kiwis. They couldn't find any. And I said, no, they have some. So why are you here? Why'd you come from the United States? Like we need more Americans, was her words. Oh, that's great. Anyway, so I start talking to her about the gospel. And I start talking to her about how, well, I came here because, you know, Jesus, blah, 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 blah. And about three quarters of the way through it, all of a sudden the haircut sped up, man. It was like we were taking our time, doing it real careful, and then she'd get dead silent. Dead silent. I remember getting back in the car and going, something's wrong with this side of the hair, right? Just dead silent. I am talking to a friend later about it, and I said, this weird thing happened. I mean, she said, oh, yeah, that happens all the time. Don't tell people you're Christian. Oh, I didn't know that. They'll treat you like that all the time. They think you're a nut job. Oh, right, they do. I've experienced it since. It's hard. I get it. But it's also a sign that you're on the same path that Jesus was on. You're king. So don't be surprised when it comes along. Don't be surprised that when the kingdom is little, when it reaches into a community and people look at it and go, you guys are a bunch of crazy people. You're immoral. You believe all the wrong things. Yeah, okay. But second, also don't be surprised if the kingdom grows from this to this. Don't be surprised in victory then, yeah? You should expect ultimately victory over all the opposition, over all the, like, you're literally on the right side of history. If that's the case, if the kingdom's gonna grow like that. The kingdom is this weird thing. The kingdom of heaven's got this weird thing. God, for some reason, has instituted it so that the kingdom of heaven and people who are in it get ostracized, and it's through the ostracization, it's through the opposition that the kingdom grows. It serves almost like an accelerant on the gas fire. That's a line that I'm using because I have experience with the gas fire. Okay, so I'm gonna tell you honestly, I'm not very good at anything practical at all. I can translate some Greek, and then beyond that, I really do need help about most things. Can't figure them out at all. So, I'm not a great homeowner. My wife's better at it than I am. One day when we were married early, we lived in this apartment, and she said, let's make French fries. I was like, cool. I think the way you make French fries is you put a bunch of oil in a pan and you just boil it, right? Just let her rip. And then you throw the potatoes in there and it does it. Okay, so we started that off and put some oil in there. And we went in the other room because it takes a while for oil to boil, I guess. I didn't know how long it was going to take. Might as well not wait. That's what you do with water. You don't wait. And so, or you don't look at it the whole time. You go somewhere else, do something else. Anyway, I came back in, and it was on fire. Who knew? Right? It was on fire. It's in this pot. And I'm like, ah! And so I grab the pot, I pick it up, and I put it out on the deck, which is like an enclosed deck sort of thing, right? Newly painted white. I put it on the deck, and I put it in the middle of that deck. And I said to her, get me some water. Now, yeah, see? Where were you? I'll go get some water. Now, I gotta tell you something really important. I I was pretty good at science in high school, but I had a teacher named Mr. Udd, who's the most boring guy in the world. And I remember him droning on and on. We used to count how many times he'd say, in his talks. And we got to like 250 for a 45-minute talk. And so I didn't pay attention to what he was saying. I was paying attention to the uhs in the middle of it. But when I got this water, I'm walking over to the pot, and I'm thinking to myself, man, I think he said something about grease fires at some point. Like, I can't remember what it was. Maybe it was add more, like, extra water or something. I can't. But for some reason, my spirit, something in my spirit, the Holy Spirit was like, Jeff, don't. So I took the water. And about halfway through the throw, I was like, no, I don't think this is right. What could happen, right? So when I threw, now, for those of you like me, and you're sitting here going, I don't know, what is everybody talking about? This is a big deal, right? Well, actually, apparently when water hits a grease fire, it explodes. Well, it did. And when it hit the thing, it exploded. And I remember when it hit it, I remembered Mr. Udd's words, don't throw water in a grease fire. And then I remember turning my head because I thought, oh, no. And it did. It exploded. There was one of these huge, like, all the newly painted walls inside the deck were like charcoal and things. But this is a great image, not for what I experienced, but like, what, it's a great image because I actually think that's what Satan thinks he's doing when he's trying to douse the fire of the gospel. What he's doing is he's saying, look, if I can just stamp it out, if I can just throw enough water on it, it's actually going to terminate it, right? So I'm going to drown these Christians out. I'm going to bury them. I'm going to oppose them through all sorts of means. But God has orchestrated it in just such a way that when Satan does that through all the means, it just explodes. And this is the way Christian history has been. And I shouldn't even say Christian history. This is the way Western history has been. Did you know that this little gaggle of 12 disciples, little fishermen, Jewish guys who took off when Jesus was being crucified, this little group took over the entire Roman Empire in 300 years. It is one of the most remarkable things that has ever happened. Without a shot being fired, man, it just took over the entire Roman Empire. There's a guy, actually, by the name of Rodney Stark, who years ago wrote the book, The Rise of Christianity. He's not a Christian, but he wrote the book because he's a sociologist. He was trying to figure out an answer to this question. How did a tiny and obscure messianic movement from the edge of the Roman Empire dislodge classical paganism and become the dominant faith of Western civilization? Like, how did it happen? How did, in other words, it go from being Christians blamed for everything? Nero burned them on the stake at his parties. Nero was the Caesar. He would burn them at the stake at his parties, and everyone would cheer because everyone blamed the Christians for everything. The reason that everything's going wrong in the society is because the gods aren't being worshipped enough. And because the gods aren't being worshipped enough, they're visiting all sorts of retribution on the world. And so we need to worship the gods more. But these Christians, every Christian stops worshiping the gods and worships one God. So we got a amount of worship problem. So anytime something bad happened, like someplace flooded or they had lightning or a tornado or something, you know who's at fault? The Christians. Because clearly the gods are in charge of the weather and they're mad because they don't have enough worship. So we should burn them at the stake. Yay, good for you, Nero. Most of the persecution happened because of that kind of thing. This is what Christians had to deal with constantly. And yet, 300 years later, a little bit less, actually 250 years later, at 313, Christianity basically became the official religion of the empire. So this guy, Rodney Stark, he's trying to figure out how this happened. And part of the way that it happened was that the Christian people, every time there was like a plague, they were the ones going out caring for the people who were sick. Everybody else was running away, but the Christians were like, yeah, I don't care if I die, I'm going to go to heaven. I'll take care of this person over here. women in the Christian circles were treated with far more dignity and respect. The way women were treated in those days were basically as chattel. A husband could use his wife in any way that he basically wanted to, and if he didn't like what she was doing, he could go out and find somebody else. It didn't matter. She didn't really have any rights or dignity at all, and yet Jesus comes along and he treats women the same as he treats men. Transformed the way women were treated in the ancient world and has until this very day. Christians would care for babies. It was normal. If you didn't want your kid, you would just commit, you'd have an abortion without any question. But if you said, oh, I'm going to have the kid, and then you had the kid, and you were like, I don't like the gender, I don't like how they look, I don't like, we just don't have enough money. Infanticide was normal. You just leave them outside, and they die. But did you know the Christians would go around door to door, and they'd pick these babies up, raise them as their own? Rodney Stark, at the end of his book, after trying to detail like the sociological phenomenon on how did the Christians actually make this happen, he reflects this way. He said, I believe it was the religion's particular doctrines that permitted Christianity to be among the most sweeping revitalization movements in history. And it was the way those doctrines took on actual flesh, the way they directed individual behavior, that led to the rise of Christianity. In other words, the gospel got inside of kingdom citizen and transformed them into being somebody who went from being super selfish to being like, how can I serve? And that changed everything. I'm going to get in trouble probably for showing you this, but it doesn't matter. You guys remember the Super Bowl? It's a little bit of a fiasco around the He Gets Us campaign. He Gets Us is a great ministry. What they're trying to do is they're trying to show that Jesus understands the plight of the human, and they're trying to show that, you know, he was one of us, right? Highlighting the humanity of Christ, which is great. They showed a video about how Jesus might have, if he lived today, would be washing the feet of people all over the society, which is fine. A pastor, though, got a hold of it and said, if you really wanted, though, to show what the gospel does to people, I'll show you what He Gets Us should have done. And so he made his own commercial. Here it is.
Don't ask me what you know is true. Don't have to tell you.
The interesting thing about it is such a great summary of basically how Christianity went from being so small to being the dominant religion of the world for a period of time, that every time the gospel goes into a new community, a new society, it starts so small, insignificant, oppressed, and then Satan, through his minions, throws water on top of the grease fire, and it just explodes. And the explosion is a bunch of little Christian kingdom people going out, having transformed lives and living very differently now. And it transforms everything, changes communities. It's amazing. If you want contemporary illustration of that, dude, just go to China today. You know, the Cultural Revolution in China happened in the 1960s. That's when Mao Zedong took over, and he had a stated aim that this is going to be an atheistic state. That we're going to re-educate everybody according to atheism. Let's kick every one of the Christian missionaries out. Let's close the country off completely from any Christian indoctrination, and we'll indoctrinate everybody with atheism. There's a project, actually, from the University of Notre Dame called Under Caesar's Sword, where they document how the Chinese government's been doing this. So here's what they said. The persecution of Christians in China takes place in three broad forms. mostly at the hands of the government. The first form is ideological eradication, which takes place through mandatory indoctrination in atheism in all schools, from the elementary level through university education and in extracurricular youth organizations. The party also transmits atheist propaganda through the mass media and prohibits religions from utilizing any public media. So anything you get that's publicly consumed there is purely atheistic. God does not exist. A second form of persecution is political repression. Religious leaders are prohibited from joining the Communist Party and thus from holding government positions. Throughout communist rule, the government has conducted campaigns to suppress missionaries and religious leaders, subjecting them to imprisonment, labor camps, torture, and sometimes execution. Since 1997, overt persecution has become less frequent, though the government adopts indirect strategies, like falsely charging religious leaders with economic crimes and sex crime. Oh, you want to follow Jesus and espouse him? What are you doing with your money? Where did you get that? How did you get that child pornography on your computer? In the Zhejiang province, 260 religious leaders were estimated to be in jail in 2015. And the government has destroyed more than 1,500 crosses and nearly 400 churches since 2013. The third form of repression is economic punishment. Christians who refuse to obey the government strictures may be fined, dismissed from their jobs, stripped of their property, or demoted. As a result, these believers face social isolation, defamation, and stigmatization. You want to ruin your life in China, become a Christian. You want everybody to shame you? You want everybody to oppose you? Become a Christian. This seems like a great way to put out the fire, the embers of Christianity. And so Satan takes it, he dumps the oppression on it. And when he did in 1960s, there were 1 million Christians in China. There are now more than 100 million Christians in China. It might start little, then it gets huge. This is the way it works, which means, of course, regardless of what it may look like now, my dear kingdom citizen friends, we are on the right side of history. That we are not, oh dear, it's never going to work. There is no Eeyore-ing in the Christian church. It will work. And the reason it works is because the kingdom of God was started by Jesus. And the kingdoms of this age will come to an end. There is only one kingdom that goes into eternity. All the other kingdoms will end. All the others will find themselves under the tree. All of them. Which means, of course, you guys ever watched a game where your team is behind and then they come back and win? There's one of my favorite videos in the whole world is of this guy who's part of my soccer team's Arsenal, and they're the top of the English Premier League. Take that, all of you. Anyway, yesterday they were behind and they came back and they won. Awesome. But you know, there was one of my great favorite videos is this Arsenal fan sitting in a room full of Manchester United fan. They call Manchester United the Red Devils because they're the spawn of Satan. So Arsenal fans sitting in a room full of Manchester United fans, and they're watching the game between Arsenal and Manchester United together. United goes up like 2-0, and all these United fans are like in his face going, yeah, yeah, yeah. Anyway, Arsenal comes back, they get one goal, then they get another goal, and then like in extra time they get a third goal, and this guy who's sitting on the thing who's been taking all of this abuse all this time rises up while all these guys, all these other dudes are in shock that Arsenal did this. He rises up and he's like, if you've ever had this happen in your life where your team comes back, that feeling, that exhilaration of like, I stuck with it and we did it. I want you to take that. I want you to bottle it up, add it to a billion other bottles of that, and know that when Jesus returns, that will all be opened up. Ah, you know, unmitigated, unbelievable joy because of the King proving that he was right, because his kingdom will go on forever and ever you are on the right side of history. So you don't need to back down. You don't need to feel sorry for yourself because things aren't going your way as a Christian in this world. They will. Soon enough, they will. All right. I'm over time, but I have one more parable. It's okay. It's short. I promise. Matthew 13:33. Okay, so the second one is about how the influence of the kingdom of heaven. Here it is. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven that a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour until it was all leaven. 3 measures of flour. That's like 50 pounds of flour. That's a lot of flour. This will feed about 100 people. But the picture is, look. You have all this massive amount of flour, and we're going to make bread for 100 people, but all it takes is just a bit of leaven, and it eventually works itself through everything. And that, Jesus is like, do you know how these kingdoms are going to be taken over? Do you know how the world is going to be affected by Christianity? It's going to be little kingdom people. When Jesus saves them and he transforms them, they become little kingdom lights that he then sends out into the whole world. And when they go out into the whole world, they shed light wherever they are. Or to change the image, they stink like Jesus, and he throws them like manure into the world, and then they smell like him everywhere. They fertilize everything around them. Yes, by the proclamation of the gospel. Yes, we go out and we say, Jesus is Lord, Caesar is not, Jesus is Lord, our government is not, Jesus is Lord, Jesus is Lord, he's coming again, bow the knee. We say that, yes, but it's not just the saying of that. It's also the fact that God, what he's taking is he's bringing cultural renewal into places by sending you to wherever it is he's got you even now. Look, let me finish by just telling you about William Wilberforce. One of the great Christians in history. You should know his name. You should know what he did. William Wilberforce put an end to the African slave trade in England. He worked together with some others to do it, but he was probably the primary person to make it happen. And he's so unexpected that he did this. He was a rich kid. He grew up with a rich family, and his family told him, if you want to have a happy, easy life where you don't have to do anything and get paid a bunch of money, go into government. Amen? And he's like, cool. So he goes into parliament, and he spends the first time in parliament just partying. It's like, this is great. I don't have to do anything. And then one Easter morning, he has this spiritual renewal. Comes to faith in Jesus. And as soon as he comes to faith in Jesus, he looks around and he says, why does God have me here? What is it that I'm supposed to be doing? Is this, should I quit? I got into parliament because I didn't want to do anything, but now I'm here. I might as well look around and see if there's something I can do. And so here's what his conclusion was. He said, so enormous, so dreadful, so irremediable did the slave trade's wickedness appear that my own mind was completely made up for its abolition. Let the consequences be what they would, I determined at that moment that I would never rest until it had effected its abolition. I will give my life to see this ended. God's got me here. This is a problem. And so one of his biographers, he said, the pathway to abolition was blocked by vested interests, parliamentary filibustering, entrenched bigotry, sound familiar? International politics, slave unrest, personal sickness, and political fear. Bills introduced by Wilberforce were defeated. Notice how many bills he brought to his parliament. They were defeated in 1791, 1792, 1793, 1797, he was sick for those years. 1798, 1799, he got sick again. 1804 and 1805. When it became clear Wilberforce was not going to let the issue die, pro-slavery forces targeted him. He was vilified. Opponents spoke of this is what they said about him, the damnable doctrine of Wilberforce and his hypocritical allies. The guy who wants to end the slave trade, he's damnable. The opposition became so fierce, one friend feared one day that he would read about Wilberforce being, quote, this is a quote from his friend, carbonated, which means broiled, carbonated by Indian planters barbecued by African merchants and eaten by Guinea captains. Everything was against him. His whole life was given over to this task. Did you know that the man was on his deathbed in 3 days? 3 days before he succumbed to his illnesses, they came into the room and they said to him, "It's done. The slave trade is no more, William." All because this guy decided that he was going to be a kingdom light where the Lord placed him. Where has the Lord placed you? "Well, I'm never going to do something that important." Wilberforce didn't think he was going to do that something that important. Seriously, what issues are you facing in your workplace, in your family life, in your sports world, where the kingdom of heaven would transform the way you do things there? Proclaim the gospel there. Yes. Also live in light of the kingdom of the gospel there. The way the world will be transformed is the way it's always been transformed. By a bunch of people who stink like Jesus enough to make it smell that way. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for my friends and thankful, Lord, for your word and for passages that talk about the growth of the kingdom and its power and influence and all of these things. It's actually quite exciting to see. I pray, Father, you'd cure us of our weakness, cure us of our Eeyore-ishness, our demure attitude toward things, the woe is me nature of the Christian church. I pray, Father, that your church would go forward in power as citizens of the kingdom that has come and will come in its fullness to rule all nations. And I pray, Lord, that you as our King, Father, that's how we'd see you. Our King of a kingdom who will rule forever and ever. Thank you, Father, that you called us to such a great task. We pray that you will fill us with your spirit to see it happen in our day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand to our feet.
Jesus, you.
Take a step of obedience. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to pray about how we can partner with you as a church and encourage you. And maybe there's some steps you need to take to be more missional at work, more missional in your life. Maybe today you were hearing Corey talk about the North Shore campus and you got a little curious in your heart. We're actually going to have some time in the Hope Center to hear more about what's going on at the North Shore. So if you're interested, please go out there. Even if you're like, I just want to know how to pray better for the North Shore campus, please go and hear kind of his vision and the mission that's going to be going on at the North Shore campus. It's really exciting. It's so cool what God is doing there. So we're really expecting for what God's going to continue to do at the North Shore and at our church here today. But as you go out on mission today, know that you are loved. Have a great week.